there will be radical change in which it will be difficult to live. We can't seem to stop everything. Stop what we're doing. Stop shopping. Until we're able to understand the imminence of our demise, we can't start over. If we can't stop shopping, we can't start living. If we can't stop the fossil fuels, we can't move. If we can't stop the consensual hypnosis under which we labor in this society, we will not be able to be collectively inventive. We all feel the despair of the unchanging public government lack of action. It's hard to imagine right now a leader who could take us anywhere, and it's probably not about having a leader. Why is it unbelievable to us that the end of the world is something that we're creating and probably starting? Why is that impossible for us to understand? Psychologically, an impossibility for Americans. I will put it to you that we have been shopping for apocalypses. That our biggest movies, which cost $300-400 million to make and market, always have the narrative of the end of the world. And we have some cute people in the foreground who are saving us from the end of the world. You know? And they're our point of view. We look out through the eyes of the cute couple. I was just watching a trailer from Independence Day. Damn! That was awful. Awful, awful stuff. When we're constantly buying entertainments, when it becomes the national pastime, becomes the end of our lives. How can we be expected to respond in a realistic way when it's actually facing us? And we have to actually face it, save our children. All the video games. Our kids are playing with their thumbs all day long, and the narrative, the story, is the end of the world. In video game after video game after video game. That's what they're concentrating on. They're trying to figure it out. They're trying to like win points inside of that or something. Seems a lot like us being progressive people, struggling, getting a few points. We're having a lot of trouble being radicals right now. We find out today that the pipeline that's coming out of the Hudson River, some of our friends went inside the pipeline and camped out for a while. Went inside the pipeline. I think we really are, Nehemiah, am I right? We're really trying to rediscover our American radicalism. We've got to be American radicals again. We have been in the past, haven't we?
Yeah.
We're going to do it again now. It's time to be American radicals again. Amen? Yeah. Amen? Yeah. All right. Sing us a song, will you, Nehemiah? Damn it.
Thank you.
with you. Responding to habitat, species extinction, and climate change. It's so obvious. I'm not saying anything is the least bit controversial, but that's sad. It's because we're unwilling to start something. Anybody here been in the office of a big NGO? They're imitating the enemy. Am I right? They're number crunching. It's all about marketing, creating graphs, written presentations, bullet point talks. It's aspirational, upper middle class aspirational. Clinton-like, shall we say. NGOs are Democrats. And it was discovered by Naomi Klein and others that most of them are accepting fossil fuel money. Huge outlays to the Sierra Club to keep them quiet from the fracking industry. A social movement is something, to coin a phrase, you die for. That wonderful comedian with the beautiful girlfriend, Jesus of Nazareth. He taught us that. You have to be willing to give it up. And all the social movements that have given us the freedom has made it possible for us to come here and be in Trinity Church together today. Let's start from before civil rights, because you always start with labor, civil rights, but let's go back to the people that founded this country. They were all willing to die. And every social movement has really created change in our identity. There have been enough people there willing to risk life and limb. Am I right? Amen. And that's why the immigration rights movement is gonna succeed. Certainly why gender rights, the cure for AIDS movement succeeded. People were that crazy. When I was in San Francisco in the 70s, outrageous. It really affects our church of stuff, shopping, gospel choir music, doesn't it? If you're around that kind of dedication, amen. Who is that? Is that a dead radical calling out to me? Guess the sermon's only a few minutes old and we're in magic land already. That's where we belong. Can you hear me? I've got a cold here. It's giving me this kind of wonderful deep voice. I feel like an actor from the 20s or something. The message that the earth gives us with the superstorms, the tsunamis and the tornadoes, the droughts, the wildfires, the floods, the earth is communicating with us in myriad ways right now. She is saying to us that we have to be willing to die to live. We have to be life in service to life. And if we're life in service to life, we know that death is part of life. One of the fictions of big acts, chemical equations, is that they seem to argue that they're splicing out death. We know that's not true. The disbelief in death is a disbelief in life. And any regenerative farmer can tell you, you take the two together. So in a way, I'm saying that a social movement has evolution in it. You know that you've got to put your body back in the soil for the rights, for the justice to rise up. We've got to get down.
Point of view that death has looking back at us.
scores of species that we know of that are disappearing every week. They have a point of view, and we feel their presence. They are in the soil, they are in the wind. This is what indigenous people know, but which is so counterintuitive for Methodists. Sorry. I apologize unreservedly for what I just said. By myself, I'm damaged. Dutch Calvinist. My great-grandparents were farmers near here. They came from the Netherlands. They farmed here. Center of gravity of our world was Holland, Michigan. The way I was raised, you couldn't have a point of view from the dead. That had to be turned over to a patriarch. God. And everything about death was something that involved your own powerlessness. That all choice, all articulation, all advance of the personal identity was a gift from someone else. That you were sort of dared to meet on your own. Some kind of peace with. It was a complete abdication. The church stopped shopping. We fired the patriarch. And that's why after 9/11, so many people came into the church of stopped shopping to be with us and to have fellowship with us, because they knew that we'd outmaneuvered the patriarch, that we had figured a way. We'd studied the Gnostics, we'd studied the earth cultures, we were an urban church that had figured out a way not to have an old male god who made a bad deal with you. But now what I'm thinking about is how to be radicals again. To get out of this conundrum of outright passivity, of being consumers or militarists, unable to act, or, as is the case with a lot of my friends and myself, to become not just activists who are self-congratulatory and working with each other in closed systems, but to go out beyond the silent E at the end of the word change. Anybody following me here? To fly out beyond the words that describe our revolutionary activity, to go beyond our most treasured words, to go beyond the word revolution, to become as strange as the heroes of the social movements that we study and think about. They were doing something that was unanticipated. They forced change by going out beyond their strategies. And that kind of strangeness in American society we're very afraid of. Why is that? We seem to worship a rock star who does something amazing and just makes us go, "Oh, Prince, please. I love it." You know what? We love our eccentrics. But for a long time, the eccentrics that we've been, the people that make quote unquote change, that seem to be flying out beyond the silent E at the end of change, they seem to be extremely rich. Beyonce the Black Panthers at the Super Bowl halftime show. But then she accepts $50 million from PepsiCo. I'm pretty sure that the new American radicalism will have to involve the risk of not being rich. Am I like going off the end of a cliff? I'm like Wile E. Coyote. I don't realize I'm about to drop. I'm still dancing for the camera. These animals in this song, the bats and the wolverines and the lichens, were threatened in this song. They are talking back at people and telling us that our imagination won't be enough. That we can't dream our way into nature. We have to be nature, to be with nature. A great painting won't get us there. Walking naked through a forest might. We need to have the threatened animal's point of view by way of our own dying, by the way we risk the loss of our personal identity, our culture, our wealth, our comfort, our convenience. It always comes down to one thing. The earth is a living being. The earth is alive. It always comes down to that. I was at the World Social Forum in Montreal, and people like Tom Goldtooth, they were going from session to session. There were like 600 different sessions in this college. And the First Nations people, everybody wanted them to come to their sessions. Because everybody was trying to integrate social justice with earth justice. That's what was happening this year. Everybody knows social justice and earth justice are the same thing. Not that you could ever get a major NGO to ever mention Black Lives Matter, but everybody who's really serious about change, everybody knows that that's the job we have right now. It's not about social justice and earth justice being sort of integrated or like comfortable with each other. They're the same thing, boom, at the same moment. We have to figure that E equals MC squared equation out. Earth-a-looyah. That's what that is. Earth-a-looyah. Earth-a-looyah. We just have to have that. We have to figure that out. For a Western white person, that's a long riddle to solve. But that's our job. So again and again, for a while I just followed Tom Goldtooth around from room to room. I just opened the door and like follow him in. And he would just sit there. And people like kind of present what they've been doing. It was always good work. You know? Really high level, you know, battling with poisons